And we need it on speaker view. That's me. And it looks different. Okay, so welcome to another Hangout, Heretics Hangout. It's been a few days, I mean. So, 2017, new topics, new venture, new people. Hey, Kirk, glad to see you. Nice to see you, Dwayne. Tonight's topic is female pastors. A very controversial topic, obviously, if you've been following Jory Micah, how God is both female and male. Yeah, very interesting indeed.
She's got more problems than that.
Yeah, she's got a lot of problems, let's face it. But, you know, we're basically trying to look at what does the actual word say. This is what we want to bring it back to. What does actually Scripture say in regards to female pastors? What is an actual pastor? Where would we actually go to look for where we actually would find these definitions? And I think the first thing that we'd actually go to would be basically a lot of people talk about the verse in 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy 2, 12 to 14. But I do not allow a woman to teach or exercise authority over a man, but remain quiet. For it was Adam who was first created and then Eve. And it was not Adam who was deceived, but the woman being deceived fell into transgression. Well, that's just a cultural verse, right?
How?
Because that's what they did back then. But obviously today, because we're a lot more civilized, we don't do this.
If it was cultural, you wouldn't bring Adam and Eve into it.
Well, look,
the fact that you brought Adam and Eve into it means that it's something that's straight from Genesis, from the very creation account.
Yeah, I agree. Let's stick with the first part of it, though. But I do not allow a woman to teach or exercise authority over a man, but remain quiet. Is this verse basically saying that a woman shouldn't say anything at all?
That a woman can't what?
Shouldn't say anything at all.
No, I don't think that's what it's saying.
No.
What do you think that it's saying?
In the go ahead, yeah.
Talking about authority and teaching. That's what it's specifically saying.
My authority.
The man holding the baby is claiming authority.
What baby? You can't see it on screen.
Well, either that or you're acting like you're one of those new Pentecostals where your back wasn't
gone. Yeah, I'm shaking snakes here.
Well, huh? Well, we do see the Greek word there is Hezekiah, to be quiet, to keep it down, not actually to be like totally silent. It means that I think it is really relating back to a cultural part there in the sense that in the synagogues, men and the women were separated, one on one side, one on the other side. And I do believe that when a woman had a question about what was being said or preached about, she would shout across to her husband. Hence why it's saying there that a woman should keep it down, you know, be quiet in that sense.
Yeah.
So that, I think, is a cultural kind of a verse as to what they actually did there. But then we do get into the other one, you know, for it was Adam who was first created. That the context of culture right there, I think. He ties it into the creative order, which brings us back into the federal headship, you know, like a man being the head of the actual family there. Now, is that the only verse that we know where it basically talks about female pastors?
No.
What's another one?
All of them. Another good one is 1 Corinthians 11, and there's a purpose for us sticking with the New Testament. One, because it's the last word that we have from God's from God on the matter. But you know, there's any number of ways that we could address this. One, does God change? Two, is God going to give us his last written word, and then be like, you know, 2,000 years later, well, all that's changed, you know. So people like Jory Micah, they've got multiple issues, and her issue is, one, the continuing revelation, which, let's be honest, usually any new revelation we get pretty much throws away or contradicts what is in Scripture.
Joseph Smith.
Yeah. Joseph Smith, Roman Catholicism, although they don't claim it's a new revelation. They have to be, seeing how some of the dogmas they hold to were never taught in the early church, despite what they say. And just so we can clear something up, though, because some people are going to kind of freak out, and they're like, oh, so it's the woman's fault. Well,
yeah.
Yes and no. First off, the woman was deceived. Adam wasn't deceived. Adam made an outright willful decision where the woman was deceived. And, you know, this, I'm just saying.
No, I understand what you're saying there with that. And, you know, I think we do need to reiterate that we do. I personally feel that, you know, women aren't appreciated in the church as much. That women are important, just as important as men within the church. But Scripture does clearly lay out set roles for different people. And I think we need to establish that there, that this isn't us. This is what it is. And this is kind of what we're actually talking about right now with it.
Oh, should we get Lydia's perspective on that verse? She just joined us. We need a woman's perspective.
She's probably busy cleaning the kitchen.
Is she making a sandwich? Wow.
She's screaming.
She is smiling.
So what do we think the definition of a pastor actually is?
Shepherd. Overseer.
What is the Pope?
Pope is the shepherd of shepherds.
Yeah, baby.
Did you just call him the shepherd?
He is. Shepherd of shepherds.
Wow, the shepherd. The shepherd of shepherds.
Somewhere around there. Yeah, in that one moment, right?
He takes the role of the Holy Spirit. Well, I guess maybe John 20 might be the route to go. Feed my sheep. And there it is, 21, I'm sorry. But, you know, if we just get a slight exposition here of what's happening, you know, the importance of feed my sheep. You know, do you love me? Feed my sheep. You know, a shepherd is someone who studies the Word of God and preaches the Word of God to the church. Now, he's not necessarily the guy that does everything in the church, but he's definitely someone who prays for the church, looks after the church as far as their spiritual growth. He's not someone that does this by himself. He has other elders around him. If you're Baptist, all those elders would... I don't know how to really explain that. And I don't think we need to really go there necessarily to talk about the differences in government.
Well, if you need to explain it, use words.
Well, I can't, so. I just never really studied Presbyterian church government that much, or Baptist for that matter.
If you can't use words, use interpretive dance.
But basically, hold on. Are you going to say something, Dwayne?
I was going to say maybe there's a couple memes for that.
Yeah.
Yeah, it should be.
Yeah, I've got a meme for Lydia.
Yeah. Well,
she doesn't like it, though, but it.
I know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Is that?
The Johan meme.
Yeah. Silence!
Oh, yeah.
Go back to shepherds.
Yeah, we got off track. I'm sorry.
They watched their flock.
I mean, technically, we should all know this, but... That tells you where we're at here in our theology.
There's a description in Timothy or Titus.
Yeah, we're getting to that one though.
Yeah, but you're asking what is a pastor, and the description is in one of those. If I can find it.
And he's going to address that. Before we turn to an explicit delineation of the authority of the pastor teacher, it should be pointed out that every Christian has a ministry. Every Christian has an office, a mission to the world. It is, however, misleading to say that every Christian is a minister. Rather, he has a unique gift. 1 Corinthians 12-14, could be talking about the chapters, and is called to testify in his own calling by word and deed. In a Reformed view of life in the world, there are no secular callings, but all vocations are to be performed for the glory of God and under the direction of God's word. An extreme position is represented by Arnold Kuhn when he suggests that the church is now ready for and its God-given mission demands the complete abandonment of the clergy-laity distinction. This position cannot be accepted, for Ephesians and the pastoral epistles make plain that the church has a specialized ministry. Some men were set apart and given by the ascended Christ to the church for its edification. The pastor-teacher is to serve the people of God in such a way that they are able to perform their ministry. Uh-oh. It is Anabaptistic to carry the concept of the priesthood of believers to the conclusion that there is no distinction between the clergy and laity. It is reformed to recognize that all believers have a ministry, but there is a special office which is God ordained and serves to the equipping of the saints for the work of service to the building up of the body of Christ. It was Calvin himself who saw the importance of the pastor teacher for the reformation of the church. We must allow ourselves to be ruled and taught by men. This is the universal rule which extends equally to the highest and the lowest. The church is the common mother to all the godly, unless you're Roman Catholic and then it's Mary, which bears, nourishes, and brings up the children of God, kings and peasants alike, and this is done by the ministry. Paul and Peter are both going to address that submission to the overseers of the church, which we would normally call elders. The pastor is definitely part of the group of elders. He is not the sole one, or like, you know, his vote counts for 5 votes. It's not anything like that. At least it's not in Presbyterianism.
What are you reading from there?
Ligonier.org. Learn articles, the pastor, his identity, and authority.
I think I read something similar in Grudem.
So.
I guess I kind of have a question.
Go away. Yep.
You kind of do.
Go away. Go away.
Along the line of teaching, are we going to lump prophecy into that as well, because there were prophetesses in the Old Testament as well as the New. And I guess that can kind of be lumped into a category with, I mean, I don't know. Does it?
No, I don't. It doesn't fit the category of instruction.
Depends if you're a cessationist or not.
No.
I'm having a night off from being a cessationist. If we go back to some, if you go back to about that, though, like the prophecy was, you never saw the prophets as known as, or seen as part of the visible church in the way that they were part of the priesthood in any way. I think that when you see something like the visible church, you see that there is a structure there, and it was always like a man who was in charge. You know, the priests, for instance, of Levi were always men who were doing all the things there. And they still had prophetesses at the time. They still had Levi priests. So you never see, though, that a prophet or a prophetess was there teaching. It was always like a priest, I would say, who was doing all the teaching. So I think we got to establish that there's two different offices there. And prophetesses are basically of today, they're all false teachers anyway, so we don't worry about that.
Pretty much. Like, there's a difference for me to stand up in church and read the Word of God, and which I don't do, but I'm giving an example because you'll find that at places like Tim Keller's church, Redeemer Presbyterian. There's a difference between the person reading the text aloud to the congregation and the pastor who exposits the text and gives it application to our lives and ties the text to the context of redemptive history.
Yeah, that's something that I spoke with someone a little while ago about. Do they class reading scripture out as teaching? And it's like, because there's that verse, you know, all scripture is edifying and teaching and that. So does that then stop women from reading out scripture in church?
No.
Because,
for instance, I could say to you, Jesus wept. Have I really taught you anything? No, I'm just basically reading a scripture there. I think when it comes down to teaching, how are you actually seen within the church? I'm not seen as teaching, per se, as when I'm just reading what scripture actually says, because I'm not saying anything. You know, how you're taking what I'm saying is you're interpreting what I'm saying. But it's not me teaching you anything. You're not asking direct questions. I'm not saying because of this and taking you back to a scripture and showing you why we actually believe what we believe. That's kind of what I think teaching is there. And that's why I think women are still okay to read scripture in church, because they're not really teaching or expounding upon what scripture is saying. I think that's the difference there. Like Chase said, you're tying it into cultural things, historical things. You're tying it into the relevance of your life. That's part of then expounding upon what that scripture is actually saying. I think that's the key part there.
Okay. So then are they exempt from any kind of leadership, or?
They can lead in the kitchen.
No, because even with Timothy, you know, his mom and his grandma, you know, acquainted him with the scriptures. I don't think there was any kind of formal training for Timothy in as far as even attending synagogue or anything like that. I mean, he wasn't even circumcised until a later date. So,
ouch.
It was pretty much just on his mom and his grandma to, you know, acquaint him with the scriptures and teach him the scriptures. You know, the woman is still in authority over the children, and even can be in authority over other women. And I would even say could probably rebuke a man. To be honest with you, I mean, I don't see why she couldn't. You know, if you're sinning, you're sinning. And they probably wouldn't allow that in the culture. I don't know if we find any examples of that. Well, yeah. I mean, we've got, what's her face, Deborah, the judge. So she was definitely rebuking people.
Yeah, that's a little out of context, yeah. I mean, a judge over Israel is different than a member of a church. The church came up quite a bit later. There's different rules set down for the church.
Well, I'm actually looking for if there is a precedence of a woman rebuking a man at any time. And
well, I don't really rebuke Barak because I wouldn't really say that was a rebuke as such. I would basically say it was because they describe her as a prophetess again. And, you know, she's basically saying, because you're basically a cowardly Presbyterian, this Baptist woman's going to go out and kick these Catholics' butts, and you're going to get the fame for it, is basically what she was saying. So was it really a rebuke? Rather than it was more than a... an indicative statement of what was actually going to happen.
I don't know. I mean, she did tell a guy, you know, what was what. And, you know, I don't think it's out of character.
Yeah, but was she actually rebuking him? And or basically, well, rebuke's not the right word, I don't think. I think it was more like...
pulling him up.
I don't know. I could be wrong as well on that. But I think what she was saying, though, was more to the fact that here was a man who's meant to be a leader of the army. He's meant to be like the guy in charge and the guy who knows how to get stuff done, basically. But here he is acting a bit cowardly. You know, a bit like he's from California or something, a bit liberal, a bit handicapped. And sounds like a typical Welshman to me, you know, but he... and it's a case of he wasn't doing what he was supposed to do. You know, like God ordains things for men to do. He was supposed to take charge of being the leaders. Here was a guy there who was basically just backing out of his God-ordained role as a man. But was she kind of basically pointing that out to him? And saying because he's not going to step up, somebody else will take his glory, her, because he's not doing what God ordained him to do as a man kind of thing.
Well, I mean, there's a yes and a no there. You know, she was already called to be a judge. She was a prophet. So technically speaking, I mean, I don't know, you know. Did the judges operate by calling out people's sins, or did they just operate in calling out judgment and executing that judgment?
Yeah, maybe. Maybe she thought. It's kind of difficult to say. I do think, though, I mean, what made her a judge of Israel? I mean, was she actually sat in a judgment seat, actually, you know, judging right and wrong between people?
I think judges seem to be like leaders that were brought up when Israel needed it. They weren't like judges as such, as we would know them now, but they're basically like leaders who would rally the nation to do God's will.
So it's just people that God raised up is what you would say is who the judges were?
Yeah. I suppose New Testament would...
Wow.
Apostles, maybe? New Testament version of apostles, maybe?
No, I wouldn't go that far.
You need to think it through more while you're staying up all night getting and get back to us.
Well, come on, it's like half one.
Is that all? No, no sleep for God's soldiers.
Okay, I'll call you up then when I wake up.
You can call me all the times you want. Whether I answer is a different matter. See, the way I kind of look at it is, you know, that a lot of people try and say, use Deborah as a reason why, you know, a woman can preach or, you know, stand in the pulpit is because they see it as a leadership role over God's chosen people. So Deborah was basically raised up by God to be in leadership over God's chosen people, hence why women can preach. What would we say is kind of wrong with that?
A king doesn't make a priest. A king and a priest are two different roles within Old Testament Israel. So just because he was ruler over the nation doesn't make him the priest who teaches people the word of God and what the word of God means.
Where did you get the king from? I didn't say anything about a king.
Well, I got the king from because we're looking at leaders of nations here. So I'm just addressing that argument. Just because you're in charge of a nation doesn't mean you're to be the priest of that nation as well.
And I think people who are for female pastors would probably agree with that as well. But what they will say is there's a comparison between Deborah and female pastors today is that God raised them up. She wasn't the king of the country, but she was to be spiritual charge, hence that's kind of what they say about it. You know, she prophesied, she basically rebuked the so-called leader of the army, the so-called lead, the head man of the actual nation. When she spoke, you know, like a prophecy out, and she spoke about the prosperity of God's chosen people, like we kind of use that term today to relate to the church as God's chosen people. So they find the comparisons there.
Yeah, but the problem is, though, trying to use Deborah as a comparison is, one, she's still not a priest. Two, just because she had the authority to execute the law still doesn't make her a priest any more than a king. King Solomon was a priest. King Solomon had the authority to execute justice according to the law of God. He was the ruler of the nation. He gave us scriptures. Where are the scriptures that Deborah wrote? You know, well, I mean, they see what I'm saying? It's still a categorical error.
Yeah, I understand that. And but they may come back there then and say, but Peter says that we are a royal priesthood now. Is that not applicable to women?
Not in that sense. No, it's not.
It's not.
No, it's not. Because that goes back to the distinctions that Paul makes in 1 Corinthians 12, you know, about the different offices, the different gifts. Okay, just like there were prophetesses in the Old Testament, there are prophetesses in the New Testament, and they are still not given the authority to head up the church.
Well, from the standpoint of apologetics, if someone were to bring up the argument about the royal priesthood, the first thing that comes to my mind is this royal priesthood is an analogy. It is a comparison to something else. And if we're going to take that something else, that's the premise that we have to start with. Otherwise, we're making assertions about something that was an analogy that was made in a completely different context. And that doesn't make any sense to do it like that.
You want to explain that some more, Chris?
I'm sorry?
You want to explain that a little bit more?
What do you mean? Okay. Well, the royal priesthood has to deal with the Christian church and its state before God. So we have kind of a function that, as far as I understand, it's dealing with the fact that we are bringing the kingdom of God to earth. And the application of that is just completely different than saying, well, we're serving altogether a official function of the church, which is an institution on earth. That is, I mean, it's the way that the kingdom of God operates, but it just is completely different. It's an institution that God has established with a pastor as being the head, the elders being the head of the institution, and it functions from there. And Paul is very specific about that. So it has nothing to do with the priesthood, which is a much more generalized thing that doesn't really have to do with that category. If that makes sense.
Yeah, it's very clear, like mud. Let's get the verse up and see what it actually says. Peter 2:9. So you would you say that this any of this is applicable to women then? But you are a chosen race, royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, so that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness into his light.
And
so you don't think that's applicable to a woman?
No, I don't think that's applicable to the institution of the church.
Right. It's applicable to women. It's just not applicable to a woman becoming pastor of the church and heading up the church.
So basically, this is applicable in an individual sense rather than a corporate sense.
Well, it's applicable to all Christians. But it's a different category than the leadership of the church, which is addressed elsewhere in Scripture.
Women do proclaim the glories of God.
Absolutely.
And some of them do it not very well. But let's get into that verse, and we talked about what it actually in Titus 1. 5 to 6. So I think we could probably safely say that this would give you the qualifications of what it means to be an actual elder. Yeah, basically, Paul says to Titus, for this season, I left you in Crete that you would set in order what remains and appoint elders in every city as I directed you. Namely, if any man is above reproach, the husband of his wife, having children who believe, not accused of dissipation. We would probably say that's kind of like the standard of what you'd expect for an elder to be.
So what passage was that again?
Titus 1, 5 to 6.
Are you going straight for Titus? Okay, so what elders are, and are they different from pastors, or are they the same, or?
Well, we know that a pastor is supposed to be like the shepherd of the flock. He's supposed to oversee it, hence the term overseer. But basically, a pastor is an elder. He's somebody who he teaches, he preaches, and I would say that they're basically the same thing.
Okay, but is there kind of like a leading elder, or are they all equal?
I would say that, you know, the kind of way it works is that there is a... Oh, yes.
Is this getting church leadership styles now?
I would say that, you know, like the pastor is kind of like the head elder, but he's also... He's subject to them as well, in the way that, like, they have opinions on what goes on, in the way that elders are subject to the congregation when we vote upon things. So I would say that ultimately there has to be somebody who's the ultimate head. But even then, there's still a form of submission going on, I would say. And if we get into actually Titus, what he actually talks about there, you know, it's given kind of qualities of what you'd expect of an elder. And I think this is applicable to pastors as well. You know, basically, any man is above reproach. The husband of one wife. The actual Greek there, I can find where that is now. I did pull it up. Probably can't find it now. There we go. It is Anna Mias Gunaikos. Anna, a man. Mias is one. And Gunaikos is woman. So a man of one woman is basically what it says there in the Greek. I think that should basically close it down right there, that a female pastor can't be a man of one woman.
Right. Yeah,
unless you want to redefine your gender and just marry whoever you want.
But before we go there, where are you at? First Timothy what?
Well, if you'd actually stop playing with your vape juice and everything else going on, you know, and get with the program, you know. Instead of bossing in what I helped you at win.
I've already been rebuked by Dwayne and Lydia both, so...
I know, right? It's getting kind of smoky in here. It's like, stop it.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, we don't even have glory clouds.
Next, you'll be throwing gold dust at the screen.
So...
Charismatic Presbyterian.
It's an oxymoron, isn't it?
Yeah. We're basically looking at Titus 1, 5, and 6 right now.
Titus 1, 5, and 6.
Yeah, you probably can actually go into 7, 8, and 9 as well. I think it basically says the qualifications that we find what an elder should actually be like. I think it's applicable to pastors as well as the actual teaching elders as well.
Well, I think it should be applicable to all Christians as well.
Well, actually, if you look in there...
Except for verse 9.
Well, yeah. I point elders, not just believers, it's elders. So these are kind of like the qualifications of what an elder should be. And a pastor does fall under the title of overseer, so he is basically an elder as well.
Yeah, but they're good qualities anyway for...
But it says not pugnacious, so we know that's you out. Not fond of sordid vape gear. That's Chase now.
Hospitable. Oh, that's you out.
Sensible. That's definitely everybody else out.
We'll just call that the Christmas present.
Oh, I thought you wanted a bike.
Simon ain't got. He's not got it like that, man. I mean, after he put lights in his stairs, you know, that's pretty much it for the next years for him.
Yeah, I'm right.
That cost him 3 years' wages.
Yeah, and he had to hire an electrician to do it.
That's because there is none around here.
So... Yeah, so right there, he must hold firm to the trustworthy word as taught, so that he may be able to give instruction in sound doctrine and also to rebuke those who contradict it. Okay, so Lydia's out. Older man, salvation. There's something else we're missing.
That's where we were.
14, kind of covered that a little bit. We're going to Titus 1, 5, and 6. I mean, you've got two very good scriptures right there saying what a woman should do and what an elder actually is.
Right. I mean, in reality, it's really not a question of if a woman should be head of the church. It's just not. There is no question there.
But we do know that Galatians 3:28 says there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ. Hence why women can preach.
But does that means then that we're...
Categorical error. Out of context.
If you took it logically to that conclusion, then that means that every single believer in Christ is literally one person with one brain. That doesn't work.
Well, actually, if we put it back in its context there, we know that actual verse scenario is talking about salvation, not church qualifications. That's the difference there. So context, again, is a big, big deal on this.
So at the very least, a woman can be saved.
Well, you know, with man, things are possible, but with God, all things are possible.
Well, those passages in Galatians and Colossians is specifically in reference to salvation. Who gets saved? What kind of distinctions are there? And that's exactly what's being addressed there. There is no distinction. If you are a human being created in the image of God, salvation is for you. It's, oh, well, you're black, so no, we can't give you the gospel. Oh, you're a woman. Well, no, you're not. That's not at all what's that. Paul's addressing two different things. You know, if we want to know, can a woman be a preacher in the church, we need to go to those passages that specifically address the role of elders, not deacons, and, you know, and church order. You know, and Paul specifically ties this to the creation order as to how the church is supposed to be set up and operate.
So what if it was a church full of all women?
They need to get a man.
Is that because they're incapable of leading themselves?
That's you out then, Simon.
Not at all. That's not what that's about at all. It's about submitting to God is ultimately what it's about. When we look at the fall and what happened at the fall and how Satan went about it, Satan started at the bottom to disrupt the creative order. That's his plan. That was the way he goes for it. Adam's problem was not doing what he was supposed to do as the man, and that is remain faithful and true to God's word. Eve was to remain faithful and true to Adam as her head.
Why do you think she didn't?
Because the serpent is slick.
Not slick?
Yeah. No. We'll be careful here.
I know. I'm teasing.
The Mormons rejoiced at that one. Yeah!
Yeah, I bet they did.
So, I'm looking for it, but I can't find it. Well, sir, we're in Titus, so I guess I was in the wrong spot then. Maybe 1 Timothy is where it's at. Unless I was there. No, I wasn't there. Yeah, that's that one. So, the saying is trustworthy. if anyone aspires to the office of overseer, he desires a noble task. Therefore, an overseer must be above reproach. The husband of one wife, sober-minded, self-controlled, respectable, hospitable, able to teach, not a drunkard, not violent, but gentle, not quarrelsome, not a lover of money. Wow, man, I just got ruled out. He must manage his own household well with all dignity, keeping his children submissive. For if someone does not know how to manage his own household, how will he care for God's church? He must not be a recent convert, or he may become puffed up with conceit and fall into the condemnation of the devil. Moreover, he must be well thought of by outsiders so that he may not fall into disgrace, into a snare of the devil. Deacons likewise must be dignified, not double-tongued, not addicted to much wine, not greedy or dishonest. They must hold the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience. And let them also be tested first, then let them serve as deacons if they prove themselves blameless. Their wives likewise must be dignified, not slanderers, but sober-minded, faithful in all things. Let deacons each be the husband of one wife, managing their children and their own households well. For those who serve well as deacons gain a good standing for themselves and also great confidence in the faith that is in Jesus Christ. Or, well, it says Christ Jesus. So, here's...
Verse 5 there is a perfect one. But if a man does not know how to manage his household, I mean, that's speaking of federal headship right there, in my opinion. I also think it's one that we tend to overlook. In the state for the man, for instance, he must be able to manage his own household well, keeping his children under control with all dignity. I've seen a lot of elders whose children are pretty rebellious. So would you think that could disqualify him then for the role of eldership?
Well, I kind of wonder about that, because what about the husband of an unbelieving wife? You know, is she going to submit to him?
No.
I mean, she's already not submitting to him by not accepting his faith.
Uh-huh.
So right there, you know, there's already that issue. You know, and who knows how far down the road that goes, because her worldview is entirely different. Her worldview is, I'm a woman, hear me roar, versus I'm a woman made in the image of God. You know, if that makes sense. So I these are questions I have myself that I haven't gotten into. I mean, this isn't something I have to deal with for whatever reason.
No, I look at it myself. I think, you know, looking at my own children who don't believe. So I think it would disqualify me from the eldership. I also think a man of one wife also refers to the married sense. I think you should only be married once as an elder. But we do have qualifications here that I think are pretty...
I think there's exceptions here to those rules.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I know we can debate on those, whether they really are or not. I think you have to be convinced yourself ultimately as well.
Well, it comes down to, can you be remarried? And at the same
time, I agree. I think we can be remarried, but I think here we're talking about the office of like an elder, especially.
I think the intention is for the individual who is holding such an office, right? That, you know, scripture says that they're beyond reproach. And part of that reproach is your family members. So, you know, as tragic of a situation as it is, if your kids are off and not, you know, with the Lord, or they're rebellious or whatever it is, that rebellion is going to come back on you regardless of how pure of an elder you are.
Yeah.
I mean, they just have to say one stupid thing, right? And your ministry is totally whitewashed, gone.
Yeah.
So that I think, it's a protection of the ministry and a protection for the individuals who are kind of under that ministry. So I think
that's a misunderstanding, you know, because a lot of times the way things are applied is, you know, you've hurt your testimony by such and such, you know. I don't think that's it, because our testimony is about Christ.
Yeah, but I'm not talking about testimony, right? We're talking about a leader in a ministry.
Yeah, absolutely. But you have to understand there's a distinction between what he's doing and what his grown children are doing out there in the world.
Well, that's it. They're not really children anymore when they're grown. So that's kind of a...
But I also think it's taking things way out of proportion. I think it's talking about, when it's saying husband of one wife, it's talking about specific people who have like several wives at once. And when it's talking about unruly children, it's talking about people who aren't bringing up their children in the faith. If you're bringing up your children in the faith and then your children decide to go against that, then I don't think that disqualifies you. I think it's the heart of the matter is whether you are bringing up your family the right way. I don't think it's talking about, you know.
So then what you would be saying is that if you were to, you know, do all the right things, pray with your kids, have Bible time, you know, all this stuff, and if they still turn out to be rebellious, that doesn't necessarily disqualify you for ministry.
No, I don't think it should. Okay. No. I think that would...
Well, I don't know. I think that's down to your personal conviction as well. Me personally, I think it does disqualify me.
Well, I think Calvin probably agrees with you.
A Frenchman agrees.
All right, that settles it. We're done.
Calvin, heretic.
Yeah.
But I can tell you this. I didn't concede. I mean, I don't agree with Calvin on everything. But we've got a man who was divorced and is now remarried and has been ordained a minister in the PCA church. And I guarantee you that's not something they just, oh, well, okay, moving on. That's not how we ordain people in the PCA. We dive into that. Your life is an open book in a discussion. If you want to become a minister in the Presbyterian Church, they're you know, you'd have a better chance becoming CIA. That's probably not true, but
you definitely need a beard.
It's easy, trust me.
So with that being said, is an unmarried man disqualified?
Hold on. Another exposition has been more generally received. Okay. He's not actually necessarily agreeing with that. That the person set apart to that office must be one who has not been more than once married. That one wife being since dead. So that now he is not a married man. But both in this passage and in Titus 1:6, the words of the apostle are who is and not who hath been. So he's making a distinction, and so Calvin's actually would be agreeing here with Gethin, what's your name?
Rob.
He's making that distinction, not who hath been married once, but who is only married to one wife. However, I think that this still fits, you know, in the paradigm for acceptable divorce and unacceptable divorce. I think that's still
fair.
So basically what Calvin's saying is if you get divorced and you want to be an elder, kill your wife. That's kind of what I'm hearing.
No, it says right here, Calvin says, if Simon Ben wants to be the elder of a church, he must become Presbyterian. I'm reading it.
Well, I am old, so, you know, me and Calvin do go way back.
Yeah.
But I do think if you go into it a little bit more where it talks about having a good reputation as well, you got to think about how people will actually perceive you to be in that role. And, you know, we always listen to people whose life that we do find attractive, or we do find that their life is it seems to be on the straight and narrow. They seem to have got everything together. So you're going to listen to those kind of people more, where if you listen to a guy who, you know, has got like five or six ex-wives in the background, different kids to them all, and you're kind of probably not going to listen to him as much. But that being said, you know, maybe if you're going to listen to a pastor who's been married to the same woman for years, his kids went rebellious and then came back to Jesus, maybe you'd want to listen to him some more. He kind of like falls out of the qualifications, in the sense that his kids became rebellious. They were still children at the time, you know, maybe like 15 at the time. But they came back. So I think we still got to be careful. Like, it's not our testimony as such, but I think it's definitely our the witness of our character we got to be aware of.
Totally agree.
Well, absolutely. But, you know, there are other factors that really are in consideration. I mean, okay, we already know it's not a recent convert. Okay, and I think we're kind of getting off of topic of women. Elders, but you know, not a recent convert. Okay. And you know, I've used Paul's statement to Timothy, don't let people, you know, look down on you because of your young age. Well, I use that out of context, and the reality is, you know, Timothy wasn't a recent convert. So, you know, if we're considering that as well, you know, their past life, okay? Say they've been in the church for 5 years, okay? You know, they take care of what they need to take care of. They work quietly with their hands and mind their affairs, you know, to put it in the terms of Scripture. And that is, you know, we're not trying to cause problems out in the world. You know, we're not hitting up the bars, things of that nature. You know, obviously, if we're standing on the street corner proclaiming the word of God, it's going to be slightly disruptive. I think that's an acceptable disruption. But, you know, someone like me or Simon, you know, our background, where do we come from? I mean, depending on wherever you go, you know, our reputation is going to precede us.
Oh, it does.
And
I'm always hearing about you.
And our church is going to see us differently for however long we've been there, provided, you know, the grace of God is actually operating in our lives. So, you know, there are scenarios that need to be considered here as to, you know, well, he can't be an elder till he's been in the church for 20 years. And, you know, everyone in the entire town knows him to be this way. I mean, there are people here in Tulsa that they remember how I used to be. And that man is long dead. He has been long dead. You know, so, and for my church, you know, they've only known me for 3 years and what I'm about. So, you know, I'm just saying there are things to consider there, but yeah. I don't think someone in Simon's situation is excluded from the office of elder. Not necessarily. There may be things I don't know about.
I've got 11 toes.
Well, yeah. Don't even bother trying to become a deacon. But, you know, even looking at the kids, you know, the reality is that children misbehave. They throw fits. That's just all there is to it. You see in any...
Libya's children do that, bro.
You see that in any Baptist church on any Sunday. You see it in any Presbyterian church on any Sunday. Probably even see it in a Lutheran church, man. But the reality, you know, it's how do you raise your kids? How do you correct your kids? You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I do. I understand that. It's talking about your character in a way.
Are you just smacking them around, or You know, are you actually trying to instruct them and bring them up in the way of the Lord?
By smacking them around.
Yeah, well, that's okay.
It's an interesting thing, though. If we go back to 1 Timothy 3, you know, we see the conditions for overseers and deacons. And then we get down to verse 11. So I think there's definitely a distinguished mark there between male and female there. I think the split is at verse 11 because it goes into the elders, it goes into the deacons, and then it goes into women must likewise be dignified.
And make sandwiches.
Well, they are the only ones who are prone to malicious gossips. Hey, I'm just saying what's in the Word of God. You know, don't shoot the messenger. It says you're prone to malicious gossips.
Don't gossip while making the man sandwich.
Yes, exactly. So
it's not even malicious most of the time. I mean, not in my circles it isn't. But yeah, you're right. We are prone to gossip.
You said most of the time. So there are times when it is malicious gossip. So you just proved my point. Thank you. So we do see that, you know, there's definitely a split there at verse 11. And then it goes back into verse 12 again. Deacons must be husbands of only one wife. So do we think that the role of deacon is only applicable to a man as well?
Well, okay.
Is there like a working definition of what a deacon is exactly? Wasn't expecting the silence, guys.
Well, I thought you were giving the answer.
No, sorry. I honestly don't have a good definition.
If you ask questions, you're not giving the answer.
Yeah, the deacon when I was in the Baptist church and they went around fixing the building.
Well, I think basically
a carpenter is not really, you know, deacon.
I would say a deacon is a person who basically like is a servant in the church. Somebody who, you know, they walk around, they collect the money, they try and keep the place clean, they open it, they lock up. It's kind of just serving the general services required to keep a church running. That's kind of what I think the role of a deacon is.
I've always seen, like, in a similar way, elders and deacons differently. Like, elders take care of the spiritual side, whereas deacons take care of the physical side.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd say there is a little bit of overlap there, because the deacons do, at least for our deacons, they, because they're in charge of the benevolence fund, you know, they have to review the cases and see, you know, is this a continuing problem that could be averted by correcting behavior? You see what I'm saying?
No.
Okay.
If we keep coming and getting money to pay a bill here or pay a bill there, you know, there reaches a point where we have to get into their lives and see, is this a money management issue on their part? Are there things that they could cut out of their life that they don't need to have? Or, you know,
like television and vape gear?
Yeah, exactly. No, not vape gear.
Just vape gear too much.
Hey, it went to a good cause if it helps you.
Yeah, huh? It's an idol, bro. It's an idol.
Yeah.
I don't know what you're talking about.
All right. So I'm going to answer my own question. All right, here we go. A deacon, diakonos. I got two definitions here. One who serves as an intermediary in a transaction, agent, intermediary, courier. And then number two is one who gets something done at the behest of a superior or an assistant.
Those don't sound like biblical points of view, do they?
I would say, yeah.
This is a BDAG third edition.
We can find that. Even with the apostles, I don't know where it's at. Maybe it's Acts 4.
Oh,
you know, where
they set up people to feed
Right.
Widows.
Yeah, things of that nature. You know, so the apostles' job was to preach the gospel and handle those kinds of things versus handing out the food, you know, clothing, things of that nature.
So how does that actually correlate then in the say that if we see a basically a deacon is somebody who's out serving the ministerial needs, then that just has to be for deacons only and general laity cannot be involved in serving ministry needs? Are we talking about a deacon is the leadership? Basically, the deacon is basically the leadership of the ministerial needs.
It doesn't sound like that. It just sounds like they're an assistant and on like the main lead of the ministry.
Right.
Sounds like they kind of like an assistant in a corporation would go out and get you coffee now and then, right?
Or would clean the doors, PA.
Letters. At least that's what I'm getting from the definitions anyway. So again, probably the people who, you know, pay the phone bill or, you know, the hydro bill, the gas bill, whatever. Or stacking chairs.
Yeah. You don't have to be a deacon to stack chairs. I can promise you that.
They got special muscles. They can do five at a time.
Yeah. Well, some of them.
Deacons are better at it.
So do we think that office then is only applicable for a man?
Okay. Well, I don't know. I know that the PCA is addressing this specifically. For a reason, you know, one, the PCA is a pretty chauvinistic church. At least it has been in my pastor's experience anyways. So, you know, if say an elder's wife helps him serve the Lord's Supper, I wouldn't necessarily see anything wrong with that. You know, I mean, for the same reason that I can help an elder serve the Lord's Supper. I'm not a deacon. I'm not anyone special, but he's overseeing. Okay. And they're aware of my life that I'm, you know, at least in as far as I tell them and don't lie to them, I'm not doing anything that would disqualify me or bring me under church discipline.
Well, let me show you why I actually say that. Let me share this screen with you here. So basically, we say that an elder has to be the husband of one wife.
Yeah.
Then we get into 1 Timothy 3.
Verse 12.
Deacons must be husbands of only one what? Wife.
Right. The question is, does that then mean that single men can't become deacons?
But that's not the question we're asking. The question we're asking is deacons can only be male.
Well, I understand that, but if we use that to prove only male, then we have to stay with it and say that if you're single, you're disqualified as well.
I would have to agree with Chase.
Now,
but then, you know, does that then follow on to elders as well?
No.
Well, we use the argument for the elders that an elder has to be the husband of one wife. But we take that argument, we apply it to deacons, it's the exact same argument. So a deacon must be the husband of only one wife.
But that's not what we're doing with the elders, though. What we're doing with the elders is saying that they can't, that what that passage means is that they don't have two wives, that they don't have multiple spouses. We're not saying that they can't be single, you know, otherwise, you know, some of the apostles are disqualified, including Paul.
I think it's the same thing. Well, the Greek says a man of one wife.
But so actually, I'm rereading it. I'm actually kind of agreeing with Chase because in the beginning of verse 3, when it's talking about qualifications for overseers, there's all these male pronouns, him, he, whereas deacons, it's using they, them. So it's non gender, except for let deacons each be husband of one wife.
Well, the Greek there actually is the exact same Greek as we find in Timothy and Titus. Eneia gunaikos, whatever it says. Basically, a man of one woman. So it's saying that a deacon must be a man of one woman.
Let me put it this way, because also tying Titus 1:7 to this, I believe, Calvin points us to Acts 6:3. Brothers and sisters, choose 7 men among you who are known to be full of spirit and wisdom. We will turn this responsibility over to them. And that responsibility would be, you know, waiting on tables, which we did bring that up. So, graver and adumptum. You know, in that specific instance, in Acts 6:3, you know, would we say, would we then follow the application that to serve tables, it must only be men and that women can't do this? You know, and I don't think that's what's going on here. And I could be entirely wrong.
Yeah, I think the Greek there says that if you vape, you can't.
Well, if you vape, you are wrong. Yeah, that's kind of what I
My only point is that the argument, husband of one wife, isn't necessarily what we're using to prove male only.
Well, the argument's a man of one wife.
Yeah, but if you do look at the whole of the thing, the pronouns for the rest of the qualifications are gender neutral, whereas overseers and elders are gender specific to male. If you look in both 1 Timothy and Titus for elders and overseers, the pronouns are male, whereas deacons, it's neutral, except for that one verse about the husband of one wife.
That's because he was writing quick. He only gave him one line for deacons.
Well, I mean, he goes on to write 2 more chapters, so. No, my bad, 3.
When he says their own, let deacons be the husband of one wife, ruling their children and their own house as well. It's a masculine noun there.
Yeah, but what about the rest?
What rest? I am writing these things to you?
No, the verse 9. Is that masculine? They must hold the mis...
Well, it does say, deacons likewise must be men of dignity.
Huh?
Verse 8 says, deacons likewise must be men of dignity. How does a female deacon be a man of dignity?
Mine doesn't say men of dignity. Mine just
self-identify.
Says
self-identify.
Mine just says deacons likewise must be dignified.
You need to start reading that JST.
It's ESV.
Right, well, that's your problem right there.
So we could go back to verse 10 in 1 Timothy 3. It says, but let these also first be tested. I'm assuming it's talking about the individuals who want to be deacons. These is masculine plural in the Greek of T.
Yeah, because if you look in the NASB, they're all men. Because like verse 10 says, these men must also first be tested. Then let them serve as deacons.
You say something?
And their wives must be reverent, not slanderous, temperate, faithful in all things.
Yeah, it's all sounding male to me.
Yeah. Let deacons be the husbands of one wife, ruling their children and their own house as well. For those, again, those, it's not there.
Yes.
Hang on here.
Oh, you're going to start talking, are you?
Yeah, there you go. Masculine, plural, what's it called? Verb there. Not verb. My mind is having a funny thing here. But it's all masculine. Obtained for themselves. Masculine, plural. A good standing and great boldness in the faith. Jesus. It's all masculine.
Yeah, it sounds
good. Yeah, there's no feminine pronouns, no feminine anything there. From verse 8 to 10.
Not only are men supposed to lead in the church, but we're all supposed to do all the other stuff in the church as well.
Yeah, I find it highly unlikely, too, that Paul writing this, if he were to you know, make deacons women, that he would then do the opposite and then instruct that those, you know, the men with wives, that the wives have to have good character too. He goes specifically out and exclusively says, you know, your wives have to be.
Yeah.
Where is it down here? In good standing. The deacons obtain for themselves a good standing. Anyway, there's an explicit reference to a deacon's wife being of good character as well. So, yeah, see, likewise, verse 11, likewise, their wives must be reverent, not slanderers, temperate, faithful in all things.
So that's most of them out. Especially in Oklahoma, that's why Chase is single.
No, I don't think that's why. Okay. Also, I'm not certain Tim Keller is right when he says that the PCA's respect for the actions of the RPCS synods, including the statement of the 156th synod, that churches are free to elect spirit-filled women as deaconesses, played a role in the tent's eventual decision to join the PCA. I say this because none of our current elders remember this being an important factor in the decision. Okay. Anyways, that's from Phil Reichen. But he does think Tim Keller makes an important point. 10th and perhaps some other churches join the PCA with the open intent to commission, but not to ordain women as deaconesses, and to do so in submission to the Book of Church Order, as has been our practice for nearly 30 years.
So they do ordain female deaconesses?
No, they don't ordain. The question doesn't seem to be, do we ordain them? Only commission. I'm not sure what that means. It may just be based on...
That's like saying you can be a deaconess, but you're not a deaconess. But you can be one, but you're not one.
And maybe so, but I think it's more based upon the definition that Dwayne gave. And we definitely see women in Scripture fulfilling that particular role.
Which role?
The roles that he brought up.
Now, do we see them actually fulfilling that role, or do we just see that Scripture is silent on who was actually being the leadership of that?
No, we don't see Scripture being silent on leadership. Not in any way, shape, or form. But I'm talking about like Phoebe in Romans 16. Okay, there she was doing the role of a deacon.
And she was never called a deaconess.
Well, there is argument that she was or wasn't, and it really just kind of depends on, you know, what you do with that. What I'm saying is that going by the definition of what a deacon is, let's just go ahead and look it up, because women definitely are servants in the church. Oh, crap. So, First Timothy.
Somebody's got to make the coffee.
Huh?
Somebody's got to make the coffee.
Well, I do that, so.
Bit of foo-foo coffee going on?
No.
Mm-hmm.
Coffee.
So, just to see what's happening there. 1 Timothy 3:8. NIV, we don't want that. That's a non-inspired version. All right. It does say diaconess.
Another kind of consideration is when you consider the term elder, right? Presbyteros. It is a reference, one, to somebody who is just simply old age, but it's used in a sort of, you know, higher sense of someone who's appointed an elder, you know, a specific leadership spot in the church. I wonder if we have the same thing going on here with diakonos, where in its simple sense, it's just somebody who simply serves in the church. But then there's, you know, a higher meaning of that, whereas it's like an appointment or an office or whatever you want to call it.
Right, as an administrator.
Yeah.
And the actual word in the Greek is actually a masculine word.
I can read English.
No, it's feminine and masculine.
Diakonos?
Yep.
It is.
It's coming up here as masculine, the one that's used in Titus.
What you need to do is you need to get you a Strong's Concordance.
I got two.
The feminine version of diakonos is diakonia.
Okay, well, it's not showing that.
And the one used in 1 Timothy 3 is the male version.
Diakonos.
Yeah.
Hmm?
Men rule, women suck.
So anyways, as far as this particular subject goes, we have people like Tim Keller and Ligon Duncan, who are actually part of the committee that is not to reveal anything until they have finished what they're doing. What I do know is that right now the statement is not to ordain. It is to commission. Whatever that means, however we're playing that out, however we're defining that, that's what's being said right now. Personally, just my opinion, if this is so cut and dry with the text, then there isn't a question. And if the PCA goes this direction, it will cause another split, and I will probably be on the side that does not ordain women. As a matter of fact, it's not a question. I know I will be.
Yeah, I don't know. Say whether something is ordained or commissioned seems kind of like, you know, splitting hairs.
It very well might be.
It's kind of like saying, hey, we're going to make you a deacon. We're not going to pay anything for it, so you're not really a deacon, but you're still a deacon.
Yeah, that's kind of what I was thinking.
Yeah.
Sounds like.
Okay, so we've kind of laid out what a woman's role isn't. What should we then define? What is a woman's role in church?
That's easy. Kitchen and babies.
Wow.
And there's one more. And holding the coffee cup.
That's right.
Holding the what?
The coffee cup. You have like flasks over here about this big with your coffee on the morning. And it's the woman's job to hold it for you while you sing in your baritone, beautiful voice to God.
We get tiny little lemon cups.
Yeah? For what? For coffee?
Yeah, auntie. Stupid.
Okay. You need to go to a Ridiculous. Coffee church, Gethin, instead of that Pentecostal thing you keep going to.
Huh?
Okay, well, you need to stop listening to that female pastor, bro. That's what it is.
You gotta love the jewelry.
Is that what it is?
I don't think that's...
Mr. T.
Let me put it this way. Just looking at Seventh-day Adventist, which is not really where to go.
Oh, it was just so happened to be there?
No. But ordained pastors limited to males. Commissioned pastors may include females. Anyways, they make a distinction themselves. Local elders, male and females. Completely disagree with all that. What is the difference between licensed and ordained? We don't care about that. Commissioned pastors' explanations. Just to see, because apparently the Reformed Church is and has been making a distinction between commission and ordination, even within the pastoral role. So, it could still be the same thing, trying to split hairs and saying, you know, well, because this word doesn't exist, that's not what's happening. Kind of like with prayers to Mary and worship of her.
See, I guess the problem is, regardless whether you're commissioned or ordained, in the sense of the passage where it says that women are not to have authority over a man, say that they commission a woman as a teacher in a church, then the issue is even though she's commissioned, she still has authority over a man. So it's a clear, like, I don't know, I just can't separate the two. It just doesn't work for me.
Let's see. Is this by Ron Duncan? By faith online. It is by like on Duncan. The PCA is solidly complementarian denomination in its history and theology, both public and official. It is unambiguously committed to leadership in the church by God. Nevertheless, the role of women in the church is one of the hottest issues in the PCA today. Recently, we have grieved over the defection of a few high-profile PCA ministers and churches to egalitarian settings, heard calls for an expansion of the use of women's teaching gifts in the church, and heard recommendations for including women as non-voting members on sessions. At our last General Assembly, overtures were debated asking the PCA to study or approve the ordination of women deacons. This suggests that our denomination is struggling to determine what its complementarianism is going to look like in the future and how it is going to be positioned in a dominant egalitarian culture. I believe that the position set forth in our doctrinal standards is the biblical view. That is, the office of the diaconate is for qualified men only. I also believe that our book of church order is biblical when it says that the session of the church should select and appoint godly men and women, emphasis mine, of the congregation to assist the deacons in caring for the sick, the widows, the orphans, the prisoners, and others who may be in any distress or need. This is precisely what is in view in 1 Timothy 3 and 5, and precisely what deaconesses did in patristic and Reformation era churches. They assisted the deacons. They were not ordained female deacons, nor was there a separate ecclesiastical office of deaconess. Deaconess, he's putting that in quotations, were diaconal assistants. That having been said, I want to say emphatically that the discussion over female deacons is a very different discussion than the debate over the ordination of women to the pastoral office or to eldership. With the vast majority of Christendom in history and worldwide today, I do not believe that a credible biblical case can be made for the ordination of women to the teaching and ruling office of the church. The kind of exegesis required to sustain such a view distorts the plain teaching of the Bible as to make it a wax nose capable of any shape. So he pretty much should have said eisegesis, but he didn't. If you can get, I do not permit women to teach or to exercise authority over a man to mean I do permit a woman to teach and exercise authority over a man, then you can get the Bible to say anything. Okay, but the discussion of women's ordination to the diaconate is different and more difficult. First, there are essentially only two passages on which the whole discussion is based. Romans 16, 1 through 2, and 1 Timothy 3:11 in conjunction with 1 Timothy 5:9. Second, the fact that the diaconate is not a teaching ruling office, but a serving office, offers a clear and obvious rationale for exploring the legitimacy of women holding the office, even in the minds of many complementarians. Third, women have always participated in the diaconal ministry of the church. The New Testament and church history shows this. So determining the exact status they held in doing so is not always easy, and this very fact encourages some to explore the potential of recognizing a class or office of female deacons. So that's Ligon Duncan.
So he's kind of not for female deaconesses as such, but he's not talking about a role shared where ultimately there's like a male and a woman there in the role of a deacon, but ultimately it's the guy who's supposed to lead and be the head kind of a thing. That's kind of what I was hearing from that.
Absolutely. I think ultimately what it's boiling down to, and I certainly hope I'm correct here, is recognition of, you know, the women in our church and what they actually do.
Yeah.
You know, because they do quite a bit of stuff, man. I mean, if you need like a fundraiser brought together, you know, these women are on it. You know, if there's someone who's down and out in the hospital, you know, these women, on top of bringing food, you know, they're bringing cards or they're knitting something, or, you know, and I mean, I hate to sound so cliche in saying these things, but I'm just saying that these women are using their gifts to, you know, to help the church and, you know, show these down and out members, you know, that they're loved, that people are thinking about them, that the church cares about them, you know, and they're not forgotten.
Yeah, and I think there needs to be that recognition there, definitely.
Absolutely. You know, and then you want to top that off, you know, when it comes to, you know, the children's center. I mean, that's mostly all females in there. And
but do you know why that is?
Huh?
You know why that is? Because let's face it, at the end of the day, you know, there's a lot of stinky diapers in there full of some brown stuff.
Are you sure it's brown? Because sometimes it's green.
Well, sometimes it can be all kinds of colors, but it still smells that particular odor. And most of the women there are married, used to the husbands coming home, spewing up that same kind of odor because they're full of it. You know, so they're kind of used to it. That's why they're good in the women's kind of ministry in the church, and they're like looking after children and stuff. But they're used to like looking after the bigger babies down to the smaller babies.
Right, but I'm saying, you know, as they do that, they're missing out on particular things. They miss out on the Lord's Supper. They're not there when someone is baptized. You know, it kind of sucks, man. And anytime, you know, and I'm trying to get that point, even like the people in the sound booth or musicians on stage, you know, if you're serving the supper after the main congregation is done, take it to them as well, you know, because the sacraments is an important thing. Yeah. And for somebody to be a member of the body and miss out on the sacraments, you know, which is basically a hug from Jesus.
Yeah, that's a good point.
You know, I know for me, I'd be like, hey, guys, you know, I want to take the Lord's Supper. I love my God.
Yeah.
You know, so it's quite a deal, especially when people like Calvin talk about the reason for the sacraments is because our faith is weak. So, you know, if someone like Calvin needed something like that, then how much more the people in the band or the mothers in the nursery or, you know. So.
Saying that, do you think that men should be in the nursery?
There are some. We do have the occasional man in there.
Do you think they should be?
I don't see why they shouldn't.
Maybe in the role of like for a woman to be nurturing and say,
I would prefer a man not be in the nursery, but that's just my opinion.
Is that taking over your space?
If it makes you feel any better, I prefer not to be in the nursery.
Oh, I as well. But I don't see anything wrong with it. I mean, after all, the whole point of God's design and created order is that the children grow up with a male and a female role model. So I think it does good for the children to see a man in there being a man and still caring for children as well.
Just not Psy, because just
look at no, it. Not Psy.
Not some creepy dude, no.
Well, I mean, not just anybody's allowed in the nursery, you know.
I love children. I just can't eat a whole one.
Yeah. Well, looking at you, I would say that's a lie.
Ooh.
Oh, Lord, grant me the forgiveness.
He's been eyeballing Danny pretty hard this whole time.
Yeah.
Danny, the baby.
I am.
Yeah, I saw you.
That's I ate earlier, obviously.
That's about the same size as him.
All right, so there we go.
So, are we going to read 1 Corinthians 11, or?
No, you are.
No. Huh?
No, you are.
No.
I think Lydia should.
1 Corinthians 11.
What?
What verse?
Say what?
Say what?
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 Lydia's got to read 1 Corinthians, what was it?
11.
11?
Yeah.
The whole chapter.
Yeah.
Yeah, just careful. You don't want to cross the line into teaching.
Yeah.
Fine.
Read it like you're not teaching us.
Okay. I think I can manage that. Preferred version?
Yes, take.
Anything other than the KJV is heresy.
The message.
NWT.
Oh, it's this one.
This is the first part to like verse 11 or 16, I think. I don't know.
And can you read it in large print for Chase?
It's irrelevant. I don't have to read it.
Do it. Read it in Braille for Simon.
Okay. Imitate me just as I also imitate. I praise you, brethren, that you remember me in all things and keep the traditions just as I delivered them to you. But I want you to know that the head of every man is Christ. The head of woman is man, and the head of Christ is God. Every man praying or prophesying, having his head covered, dishonors his head. But every woman who prays or prophesies with her head uncovered dishonors her head. For that is one and the same as if her head were shaved. For if a woman is not covered, let her also be shorn. But if it is shameful for a woman to be shorn or shaved, let her be covered. For a man indeed ought not to cover his head, since he is the image and glory of God. But woman is the glory of man. For man is not from woman, but woman is from man. Nor was man created for the woman, but woman for the man. For this reason, the woman ought to have a symbol of authority on her head because of the angels. Nevertheless, neither is man independent of woman, nor woman independent of man in the Lord. For as woman came from man, even so man also comes through woman, but all things are from God.
Keep reading.
Right to the end.
Judge among yourselves, is it proper for a woman to pray to God with her head uncovered? Does not even nature itself teach you that if a man has long hair, it is a dishonor to him? He'll live, I promise.
Are you sure?
It doesn't sound like you do womanly duties.
But if a woman has long hair, it is a glory to her, for her hair is given to her for a covering. But if anyone seems to be contentious, we have no such custom, nor do the churches of God. Is that far enough? Can I stop now?
Yeah. Okay. So what's head covering about?
Authority.
Hiding her head in case she's bald.
You know, when I was little and I asked somebody about this verse, they were saying it's about hair.
Not at all.
They told me that head covering is just, yeah, it's fine. It's because it's hair. Women have hair, so it's fine.
Well, what I really like about this is, if anyone is inclined to be contentious, we have no such practice, nor do the churches of God. In other words, no matter what you preach and teach, if a woman is in the pulpit as the pastor of the church, it's not a church of God. Period. You can't even make that about a problem in one or two churches, because Paul applies it across the board right here.
What verse is that?
16. Here. I'll just make it easy on you. I know you're having problems, bro.
No, I found it. It's all right.
Are you sure? Can you read it?
Yep.
All right. So, first and foremost, traditions, even as I had delivered them to you. What traditions would these be? Most likely, this is the way in the order with which church is performed. This is not, you know, traditions that we don't have in Scripture, like Marian dogmas and things like that. There's absolutely no proof of that. But there are things that Paul lays down that he doesn't exposit. He doesn't go into any detail. One of those, like the Lord's Supper. When do you take the Lord's Supper? Do you take it before or after? You know, do you take it every Sunday? Do you take it once a month, once a year? You know, things of that nature. That's most likely, in all sincerity, what Paul is talking about with traditions. But I want you to understand that the head of every man is Christ. The head of a wife is her husband, and the head of Christ is God. He's really going back here to leadership and authority, how it comes downhill, and it is still attached to the created order. And he throws this in. Nevertheless, in the Lord, woman is not independent of man, nor man of woman. For as woman was made from him, what is that? Is that you doing that?
Not me.
No. Well, it's not me.
Nope, not me.
Okay, well, I don't know where that comes from. So it's Lydia. She's smiling. Where are we at? Verse 11 and 12. For as woman was made from man, so man is now born of woman, and all things are from God. So he attaches men and women together.
Just guessing.
That wasn't me, that little bit.
But found it.
That was me that did the box and the arrow. I was doing it to bring it up in a bit.
So we see that the church works as a whole and that our roles are complementarian.
You know, okay, so this bit that I've boxed in, every man who prays or prophesies with his head covered dishonors his head. What does this mean? How does man cover his head? Is it talking about hats?
With Christ, I would think. If this is a scripture about authority, then Christ being the authority of the man, at least in this passage, would mean that a man who is not covered is a man who is not under the authority of Christ.
I would say that's exactly what it is, or denying that authority.
The denying church leadership over him.
Yeah, it can include that, I suppose.
Yeah, but the passage is talking specifically of Christ's headship over a man.
Right.
And
what comes to my mind is those men who have a form of godliness but deny its power. And we see such examples like that. The most recent guy, what's his name? Jennings or... Clayton Jennings. You know, he got brought under church discipline, so he left. This is commits. Let's just see position. Let's see what Calvin. Taking the lead, as it were, of all the people, which is part of the public teacher. For Paul is not arguing here as to every kind of prayer, but solemn prayer in public. Let us, however, bear in mind that it is, that in this matter, the error is merely insofar as decorum is violated and the distinction of rank which God has established is broken upon. For we must not be so scrupulous as to look upon it as a criminal thing for a teacher to have a cap on his head when addressing the people from the pulpit. Wow.
It'll just be bad manners.
Wow. Paul means nothing more than this, that it should appear that the man has authority and that the woman is under subjection, and that this is secured when the man uncovers his head in the view of the church, though he should afterwards put on his cap again for fear of catching cold. And fine, the one rule to be observed here is to agree upon decorum. If that is secured, Paul requires nothing further. So he doesn't make it anything. Wearing a hat in church is not a bad thing. I think the point in taking the hat off is that it not so much as having the hat, but what it symbolizes, you know, that you're
respect.
That the show, the symbol of whatever it is that you're doing shows that you are in subjection to God, that there is one over you.
Yeah.
Yet for women, I guess she should wear a hat when praying. I don't know. You know, the reason is because this is difficult for me to try to read this at the same time as talk to you guys. And I don't necessarily just want to read the whole of the commentary. So...
Sorry, which commentary was that again?
It's Calvin's on 1 Corinthians 11. I've been trying to get more Calvin into my reading.
I think he does a cereal bar.
No. That the apostle requires women to show their modesty. not merely in a place in which the whole church is assembled, but also in any more dignified assembly, either of matrons or of men, such as are sometimes convened in private houses. Shaving. For it is all one, as if she were shaven. He now maintains from other considerations that it is unseemly for a woman to have their heads bare. Nature itself, says he, abhors it. To see a woman shaven is a spectacle that is disgusting and monstrous.
It's almost as bad as a woman having short hair.
Hence we infer that a woman has her hair given her for a covering. Should anyone now object that her hair is enough as being a natural covering, Paul says it is not. For it is such a covering as requires another thing to be made use of for covering it, and hence conjecture is drawn in some appearance of probability that women who had beautiful hair were accustomed to uncover their heads for the purpose of showing off their beauty. It is not, therefore, without good reason that Paul, as a remedy for this vice, sets before them the opposite idea, that they be regarded as remarkable for unseemliness, rather than for what is an incentive to lust. So this, what Calvin's saying isn't really making any sense to me, because without reading all of this in context, I'm just doing a disservice to the text, and I'm doing a disservice to Calvin. The main takeaway of this text is, by all means, authority and who has authority where. You know, when a woman does something in the church, why is she doing that? You know, is it because the task has been administered to her to go do? Or, you know, is she assuming authority?
Well, she's obviously assuming authority. That's why she cuts her hair short, because she's rebellious.
Darn right.
See, I rest my case. So what do we think a woman's role in church is then?
To make sandwiches?
Well, we know that, you know, most of the chefs are men, so even making sandwiches can, like, be done better by men.
Wow.
Sunday school?
A woman's duty in church is to support her husband, to support those who have been given authority over her, to proclaim the goodness of God, to submit to God, God's order, whether that be general revelation or special revelation. Just as it is for a man to do. You know, a man is to do these things as well. But the man has been given greater responsibility. And that's something that, you know, a lot of people don't understand. You know, God has put more on the man. It was worse for Adam to sin than it was for Eve to sin, even though both were grave. You know, they were both horrific. Even as the head of the household, you know, the man's responsibility is greater than the woman's. I could be wrong, but I don't see anywhere in scripture necessarily where it says for wives are to love their husbands, but it says men are to love their wives as Christ loved the church.
Yeah. I think he talks about women respecting the husbands.
Yeah. Submitting. Yeah.
And I tell you right now, it's a bigger job to love your wife as Christ loved the church than it is for the woman to respect the head. Mm. Wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands as you do to the Lord, for the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain, or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated their own body, but they feed and care for their body, just as Christ does the church, for we are members of his body. So it is the husband's role to consistently insist upon sound doctrine. It is the husband's role to always be that beacon that points to Jesus Christ in all things. More so than the woman is, even though the woman has this duty and responsibility as well. But we clearly see, you know, in that reading in the passage in Ephesians 5, that, you know, there's a clear direction for what the man is to do. He is to be godly. He is to love his wife. And all that means and entails versus just being a dick. You know, we even see in the Old Testament that, you know, these men who were failing to do their duty as men of God, that God wasn't going to hold the sins of their wives and daughters against them. He was going to punish them because they failed to do what they were supposed to do. In other words, God blamed them for it.
Record.
You know, where Adam blames Eve, God blames Adam.
Yeah. That goes back to a man being a lot more responsible than what a woman is. And we do see that also played out with teachers who would do, you know, the double honor and also going to be judged more stringently than we are. God holds a lot of things about being responsible very highly and holds you accountable for the roles that he's actually given you. And, you know, he takes this stuff seriously. Sometimes we don't, but we know he does always.
Yeah.
But what do we think, though? Like, so you just believe that a woman's role there is just to support a husband, you know, support the guys that are supposed to be the ones who get the church together and to make the church grow and to do the church things, and the woman's there to help the man do that, like be his helpmeet, so to speak?
Well, that's what she is. She is the helper.
Uh-huh. So we can establish then a woman's role is, do we also see that a woman then maybe not liking that role due to open rebellion?
Possible.
Hence why we're seeing a lot of, like, you know, female pastors today and seeking that which God has not set before her.
Yeah, I would say it falls into the category of Romans 1 and what's laid out there. It would be an outworking of the denying of God.
And do you think a woman might feel that way because a man's not stepping up?
Well, if that's the case, you know, there are certain ways to go about that. Like I said, we see this example in the Old Testament as well, where the women aren't charged because the men weren't doing their job. So I think there are instances, but I think any woman that seeks to honor God and what God has done would be like Deborah, you know, when she tells that man, I mean, you're the leader of the army.
Yeah. Suck it up, buttercup.
So.
Cool. Well, let's get this closed up then, because we'll not be beat on for 2 hours. I prayed last week, so who's praying this week?
You mean last year?
No, this week.
Dwayne?
Sure, why not?
Yeah, now we can see you.
Yeah, hey, there we go. It's all good.
and Lydia's suddenly gone, oh, she's come back now.
Yeah, that's right. Not me.
Someone's volunteered.
Like, I'm not here. Now I am.
All right. Well, Lord, we thank you for today and for bringing us all together to discuss your word. And we pray and ask that your word would sink into our hearts, Lord, and that you would constantly put it upon our minds, Lord, that we may think about it always. And so as we part our ways, we ask that you would bless our dealings, Lord, and everything that we do in the day. And we ask that you would continue your good work in us, in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
So is having a headset on top of your head, is that the violation there of 1 Corinthians 11?
That's a good question. But it,
yes,
it's not.
Yes,
it's not really covering my head. See,
that depends on how you define cover.
But you know what? I think I've commissioned the headset. I haven't anointed it, so it's all good.
Okay. Okay. Well.
Yeah.
Cool. All right, guys. You take care, and I'll see you all next time.
See you guys.
All right. God bless.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you.